everybody. Thank you so much for being here today. We have Dr. Ian Handiani with us today talking about undergraduate research. A little bit about her. Her PhD is in soil ecology from the University of Kentucky, and she has lots of experience with teaching. She's won numerous teaching awards. She's been the Provost Office Spotlight faculty. She's also won the Outstanding Research Award in the Hudson School of Agriculture. She has won the award for Women of the Year in Technology, as well as numerous Teaching Excellence Awards, numerous awards for being a mentor, and as well as travel awards. And she's been a Fulbright Senior Research Award winner. However, not only has she had so much experience with that and has won numerous awards, she has much experience in undergraduate research. Prior to her work at MSU, she helped with 51 undergraduate theses. That's incredible, 51. And while here working at MSU, she has also assisted with 51 undergraduate research mentees from the School of Ag, Chemistry, Biology, and BIS. So if anybody is an expert in undergraduate research, it's certainly Dr. Handiani. So thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Ms. Lilia. Good morning, everyone. I'm glad that you are here. So today I would like to share what I have that hopefully it will help you with your tenure package. I wish that I can bring my tenure package because it has a lot of undergraduate, mentorship activities that I did with my undergraduate. And I just like to share with you my experience, my undergraduate mentorship. So I started working here in fall 2006, and then since then I have 51 undergraduate research, mentees. So from different departments, from School of Ag, Chemistry, Biology, and BIS. Actually, last time when I did that, because I was the first faculty member international from foreign country, so the student not used to with my accent, and also it just, and I think I'm the only woman at the time, and I like to improve my teaching evaluation, right? And then one thing that I'm thinking, okay, the student do not know me very well because we just meet 75 minutes in the classroom, so I'm thinking maybe I should do some undergraduate research so I have more student work together with me, and then student are talking, right? Talking with each other, like, oh, take that class or don't take that class because blah 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 blah, something like that. So that's why I start, like, if I have student that like to talk to me after class, then I said, hey, do you want to? That's the first year. Like, so first year, I promote my expertise, and then also I talk to other faculty member from other department, because we have new faculty member group, something like that. So it's like, hey, if you have student that would like to learn something about soil, please tell them and then come see me, and then we go from there. So that's what I did. And then also, from that one, I have about 20 peer review journal, because I work with undergraduate. And then also I have about 20 papers and proceedings, and more than 95 presentation and abstract in various scientific meetings since 2005. So, and then also I have 14 undergraduate research award, can be poster, oral, and paper. So that's because of the undergraduate research mentorships that I try to do to help my teaching skill and also to help my publication. So hopefully we can share each other what for the future. So according to Professor Robert Wingle, actually when we talk about undergraduate student, actually is more than just an extra pair of hands to help with the numerous tasks of doing research. An undergraduate student brings an extra pair of keen eyes, and they often see research from a totally new and innovative perspective. And in my case, I always see that the question of my undergraduate student is always interesting. It's like they, with their, like, they background that they haven't read a lot. So the question is like bring me like, oh, maybe next time I should do this research with other student or with her or with him, something like that. So this helped me a lot. And then also undergraduate research is a student faculty collaboration to examine, increase and share new knowledge of works in ways commensurate with practices in the discipline. So sometimes when we are in the classroom, we only teach the theory, but they don't know what's happened in everyday life, especially because I work in applied science, something that's applicable. So I have to show them how to make it soil better, for example, how to make our agriculture better by doing something so they can reap it. And also undergraduate research is not simply this replication of old findings, but involves creation and discovery of new knowledge. So for example, I always say to my student like, okay, we will see the research from Africa, for example. The grain production is not so great over there. It's not because they do not know how to do research or they don't know how to farm, but originally the soil is not good enough like our soil here. So that's why how the way we do research will be different in Africa and in United States. So we cannot just mimic 100% like, okay, this is the research in Kenya, and then we just do everything the same and then apply here. Even how to use the tractor is different. And then how the way the social economic over there, maybe it's very expensive to buy gasoline, but here, of course, it's still expensive, but people can buy that. So this kind of thing. So we have to adjust, so not just repeating the other finding from old research. And the goal of undergraduate research is the dissemination of this finding at conference and peer review publication. So in my case, because sometimes undergraduate is not stay long, so sometimes it's just one semester, or maybe just two semester if we are lucky. I have the lucky one, like 3 years undergraduate research, see work with me for 3 years. That's my lucky time. But sometimes just one semester. So we have to think, you know, short research, but is like we can present the paper or maybe publishable, but for undergraduate level publication, something like that. So it doesn't have to be like very, very big one, like what we did when we did our graduate class research. And then to learn and grow significantly from the research experience, student requires strong mentor relationships. So that's why to make sure that the research done by undergraduate is properly, you know, like manageable and properly done, we have to have like a strong mentor relation, and we have to help them. And it's not just helping them, but actually help us a lot. And my personal experience, if I do not have undergraduate research every semester, I think I maybe will be like this, because I will just sit down like this, you know, and then you know, like just publication, no exercise. But because I'm in agriculture, maybe we have to go to the field, we have to take soil samples, so it's a lot of exercise. Sometimes it's like more than, for example, I like to do exercise just 50 minutes a day. Oh, but with my undergraduate, I can be like 2 hours, 3 hours in the field and so sweat. But I feel good because I know that hopefully I will not be like this, at least. Yeah. So, and then also the relation will begin between me as a mentor and the student, it will not kill me in terms of name or in terms of like time. Like, for example, I always have a border between me and my student. So I will not be a friend in Facebook with my student. I don't know, it's just me, you know. I always say, you can be a friend of me whenever you finish your degree here, then we can be a friend. And then I will not spend like having lunch very often with my student, like just the student all the time. Now, if I have lunch, like maybe once a month or once in 3 months with a lot of it, because if we go lunch all the time and then very close, we don't know, you know, people will talk. So that's just my for my protection, okay? So we are friends sometime, but it's not friend like that. So that's my, so, and then it will not like, sometimes I said, okay, if you go to the field, make sure if you have any problem, call me, I give my cell phone number or text me, but it will not like take all my holidays in Sunday or Saturday. So we have to set the boundary for the relationship between mentor and our students. And maybe we think that, oh, teaching is the same like mentoring, or mentoring the same like teaching. Actually, for me, it's not. And the reason, because mentoring actually is, of course, is a part of mentoring is teaching students something. But we have to give a good example, and then the attachment. We have more attachment to the students because sometimes students just come like in the afternoon, no appointment, and they're like, oh my God, I have problems in the lab or in the field. Can you help me right now? And then I know I have another commitment. I said, well, if my commitment is not so, like, I mean, have to be right at the time, then I can just go to the field and help them. But for class, for teaching, I can say, okay, do you need really, really right now? Or can you wait for 2 hours? Because I need to do this one first. You know, so this kind of thing. And then the process of teaching is only mostly like more active is during 75 minutes or 150 minutes, you know, like, and with a lot of students. So the attachment is different with mentees. The mentees, like the attachment is 24/7 for me. And maybe the reason because I'm here, you know, it's like sometime whenever, you know, that's my feeling after we finish the process of mentorship, they're just like family to me. And mostly it's like mother, daughter, or son and mother, something, whenever they finish the school, of course. And then a long time ago, maybe the recent mentoring is not so important, but right now it's become crucial and critical than ever before. Because why? Because student, especially student that has, you know, would like to go to graduate school, they hungry of information, like information that make them feel, you know, like they need to have new knowledge, something like that. So in my case, will be something that relate to environmental science or soil science, or talking about knowledge about how to improve the agriculture in my discipline. And then they like to learn about technology, the new technology also. And they expect us to know about the technology. But for me, sometimes I don't know about technology, advanced technology also. And they have more understanding than me because maybe they have internship with other company. So I learn from them and they learn from me, you know. So we kind of like win-win solution. And diversity. Here is different for me because the background of students are different. Sometimes I have students from Saudi Arabia, from China, and from, of course, from United States. So I have to learn how is their culture. So because I don't want what I say make them hurt or feel offended. So usually if I have students from, example last time I have students from India. So I try to find a book about culture about India, you know, how to deal with people from India. So I learn, and then I have faculty member that from India. So what is the common thing, custom. So I learn that one because I want my student comfortable with me, and I want myself comfortable with my student also, because that's the beginning of relationship for the mentoring process. And also the style of mentoring. When I was working at UK, University of Kentucky, I mean, not England, whenever I meet students from freshman to junior, senior, their mind is research. They already know, like, you know, like, oh, I like to do this research. So their mind is full of research ideas. But when I come here, especially in my school, at that time, in 2006, the research in soil science is not something that common. So I have to do my best to let them know that doing in soil science is not hard, and also is needed for everyday life. So I have to make sure that I make them like, oh, this is important. Oh, so if I do this one, that it will help my resume, something like that. So we have to make sure that what we did is make them like have more ideas instead of like, oh, that's scary, you know, it's too hard for me, I don't have any background. So that's why for me, if I like to have a mentees, usually I ask my student to take my class first before they make decision to take to ask me as a mentor, because they have to know my style of teaching and what is my expertise, like the real expertise. So that's one thing that important. And how do we effectively mentor students today in undergraduate research experience? Because it was different compared to long time ago when I was in college. Right now is, digital, everything is digital, and smartphone. Even in the classroom, sometimes they just the teacher talk, and then the student just do like this. Okay, do like this. And for me, I have a new method, new method in 2006, but it's worked until right now. Whenever they use the cell phone, or the cell phone is ring, or late, they have to sing a song, and it's worked very well. So they usually like, oh, make sure, turn off, or vibrate. Or if there is an emergency, they will say, my mom maybe will call me, so in case this is ring is from my mom, or from, okay, but you have to sit down in the back. So they can say, and also this will happen to me. For example, if right now I bring my cell phone and then ring, I will sing a song. It's just a second, like happy birthday song or something. Barney, I always say like, I love you, you love me, and they laugh, something like that. So it brightened the process of teaching. So that's what I did. So my student will not very stressful because they cannot work, they cannot use the cell phone, but they like, okay, pay attention to the teacher. But sometimes I ask them also to use the cell phone during the class time if they are like, so tired like that. And I said, okay, now I have question. And then nobody answer, for example, cannot answer. How about you ask Mr. Google? And then they start asking. I remember, I said, can you try to find what is the soil organic matter level in Kentucky? They try to go to the Google or everything, and then they could not find it. Of course I know, because I already tried. And then I said, we cannot find it. See, that's why you have to be in my class, because even Mr. Google need to take my class. So, so that's why, and then go from there. So if Mr. Google need my class, so who knows, who like to do research? This research, I have, special offer research, and if I have extra money, for example, funding, then, you will work this one, how many hours and how much money, a lot of students will try to apply for that announcement, so if you do that. Okay, and expectation about the mentors vary from student to student. But the most important, based on my my reading, is the expertise emphasis the socio-emotional support. Yeah, this mentorship is a little bit different with teaching because it involves the emotional things. Okay, according to Ishiyama 2007, very important and somewhat important about the role of mentor, expectation is, but it's almost the same. They like us to guide the research techniques. They really like, okay, what should I do? And then how many hours is needed? And then because I'm busy, so their schedule is different. Maybe you remember when we were in graduate school, our mind is just research, right? But undergraduate sometimes like, oh, I have to work in Fidalgo and remember all of the menu, So that's why I'm sorry, Dr. H, I cannot, work in your research. Okay, that's fine. My first, second year, he's like, oh, I'm very sad when I heard my student like that. But right now, I just let it go. And then sometimes they just come on Friday or like, I think I'm ready. I just quit, working at that restaurant. Why? It's just painful, to remember the menu. Okay. And then they like to do research. And I said, hey, how about if you make a proposal, you can apply for $500 or $1,000 or McNair, which is 2,500 or 3,000. Would you like to do that? It's nothing to lose, if you got it, thanks God. If not, then I have something in my lab, you can work with me, and then it will be good for your resume. And also you can go to the conference with me. Remember, we are team, okay? Always say like that to the mentees, we are team. So if you hurt, I'm hurt. And then the team, we will make brownies. I always say about food because I like to eat. Okay, so I always say we will make brownies. Okay, I have the recipe and you do it in my lab. Okay, and then we will present the brownies into the conference. And then do competition. And then if you win, Oh, I will treat you. Okay, that's my just. So I said, okay, let's make a brownie. So we usually I say like that for, you know, student that like freshman or second year, because if I say like, oh, you know, this research is very important. Oh, they're like, oh, it's hard. I don't want to do that. That's my experience. They will run away. Yeah. And then also, for me, this one, listen to the my ideas. Yeah. Sometimes the student like the ideas to be heard, just like us, you know. And they come like, well, I don't like the paper that you give me, Dr. H. I like to do this research because this is more interesting. But I know it's unmanageable, you know. Unmanageable. It's just you know, the ideas of freshman or a junior sometimes is like too big and then it's unmanageable. But we cannot say that to the student. They will feel hurt. So I said, oh, it's wonderful. Yeah, this is good idea. Do you have in writing, you know? Can you write in writing? Yeah, I can do that. And then she or he will bring in writing, and I said, well, do you plan to go to master or PhD maybe in the future? Yeah, I think this one is good for your master or PhD because like huge ideas. And right now, because you only have time, how long? Oh, only one semester or two semester? How about like this? I know your idea. What do you think? I will give you these references, and then see which one do you like, okay? And then go from there. That's what I did. And usually it's successful after that one. But still, we have to praise them that how wonderful is their research. And then, okay, sometimes they don't know even how to go to Google Scholar. They don't know. You're like, I don't know how to find the, you know, the scientific article. What I supposed to do? Okay, how about like this? Come on Friday, you know, I don't have class. So come, and then we work together in my computer. Okay, and then if they still like not feel satisfied, I refer to one of our colleagues in library. Okay, and then my student would like to see you, blah, 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 blah. And then she would like to know how to use the library or e-library. And then she will come to that person and then go from there. So it's just some faculty member think that it's like wasting time by doing that, but for me it's not, because I will show you that after you teach them for a month maybe or four times meeting, our student will be very independent and very confident. Even sometimes like, hey, Dr. H, do you need help? You know, I know that you have been writing, you know, proposal, and if you need help, I will help you, you know. Well, but I don't have money, you know. And how much is I have to pay? $10 per hour? No. This is free, you know, free. I will go to the library and find what is the article that you need. So sometimes they offer like that. So that's the thing that we never know the impact of our process of mentorship. And also we have to, of course, we have to support our student. And is my friend. So this one, the one that I say, you know, it's not like really friend, but we have to listen, a good listener. Sometimes my student come to my office like, I cannot work this week, Dr. H. Why? I broke with my boyfriend. I could not think. I just want to quit. Okay. If you want to quit, how about like this? Don't make decision today. Do you want to have lunch right with me right now? You know. Well, okay. Let's go lunch. And then tell me about your parents, and then after that, oh, I think I would like to join you, Dr. H. Go to the conference in October, in November, okay? Is there any competition, right? Yeah. I will show to that boyfriend that I'm still fine. Good. Let's make a brownies again. So there's something like that. So sometimes it's like up and down of the student. We have to just mingle with that. Yeah. And for me, I like that. Okay. And also, first generation and continuing generation here is a little bit different, but still the most important is the expertise. So we have to tell our student what is our expertise and also accessible, you know. For example, sometimes they just come, pop up in the office, even though I already put like office hour, they just like, are you busy? Of course, yeah, they know I'm busy, you know. And I said, oh, no, no, for you, no. No, no, nothing busy for you, you know. Yeah. What? And then, because sometimes it's like 5 minutes, 10 minutes before my class. Is that very important? Yeah, okay. How about we talk while we walk to my classroom, okay? Okay. And then, you know, I have class. Do you think you can wait? You know, you like to wait in my classroom or whenever my class is finished and then you just come. Oh, okay. Okay. So, but we were like, you know, this is my office hour. You cannot. No, if I do that, then that's the end of the world. Okay. They will not come back. Okay. And then also friendly is important. Yeah. Sometimes I just have to, you know, no matter my heart or my mood, I just have to smile. Hi, is everything okay, everybody? Have you eat? For example, in my lab, you know, sometimes they just like this, so stressed, and I said, everybody has it? Okay. If they look like very, very sad, I just come to a tea room and buy something, just little thing, you know, like snack or something. Hey, eat this snack, okay? And then you will feel better. Okay. And then usually I know that some of them maybe feel not good or something, and then usually, do you think you can stay a little bit longer and then we can talk? And then it's just heart to heart. You know, so but for me it's not wasting time because it's like investment, and then because whenever I need, and then they just come to help me right away. And male and female, well, a little bit different because for male, expertise is still number one, and then for female, is accessible. I really understand because especially in Murray State, you know, most of my students are like far away from the parents, and if they have mentor, they think like, oh, I can tell you everything, Dr. H, before I meet with my mom. Even sometimes they think like it's better talking to me rather than to their parents because the parents are like, oh, because it's you. For me, I just listen, and then I just write it down, even though it's not so scientific, right? I just, oh, meet the student, talk about this one. And I'm just thinking because I love to do creative writing, so I'm thinking, ah, this is good for my novel. Just like that. So it's always good. Yeah. So that's one thing. And but again, in general, expertise is still number one. But sometimes students is like, when the first time I come here, I put my expertise like, you know, student, you know, global climate change is, you know, is not good, right? And then for agriculture, even not good if you have global climate change. Well, my research is about global climate change, and then I give the article to my student, and they just like confused, you know, like it's like they just at that time didn't catch what I want them to catch. So I was, oh my God, this is too high maybe. And then I choose another article, still like that. Then finally I said, what is your favorite things to do? And then someone's like, oh, I just like to help my parents so the agriculture will be better, our soil will be better. Oh, okay. Then I start, oh, they like to have something that light. So, okay. Do you know how to tell that your soil is bad or good? And they said, well, if hard is bad, if soft is good. Really? And then I said, how about if we have peat? That's very soft. Do you think we can grow a corn in the peat? You know, peat or muck, you know? No, because it's too soft. So we cannot do that. But how about soil color? And then I said, oh, yeah, if we have red soil in our yard, we cannot do, you know, we cannot grow very well. Okay. Do you know how to make it the red become black or brown? No. Okay. Do you want to know how to do it? Yes. But we need to go to the field. Oh, okay. And then you need to bring this. Oh, I have. Then we go to the field, do something, and they have fun. So they say, and then after that, so what we do after this one? Well, you know, as a student, one thing is not just talking, writing. Writing is important, okay? So how about if you write a report, just, you know, small report about how you improve your soil, okay? And then send me to Canvas, or last time Blackboard, and then we go from there. And then so I will know, I make a ranking of the writing. And then I just keep doing that, and finally from 25 students become 15, 15 become, and finally become 5 would like to work for research with me. So this is the process of screening of for undergraduate research. So, and then communicative about the goals and plans. So for example, I always ask my student like this. For example, Dr. S, I like to do research because I like to improve my GPA. They think that if they take the undergraduate, they will get an A, right? Yeah. Okay, so how is your commitment? Well, I will graduate next semester. So I need to have like small research, but good, and make me have an A. Okay, hopefully we can do that. And let's see, I will see the conference first. Is there any conference before he graduate? If there's any conference, then there is a chance. But if there is no conference, that's very hard. But usually we have conference every semester. That's a good thing. So even MSU. So, and then I know the conference or workshop, and not workshop, symposium, and then I will ask the student to find literature, give just 1 week, and then tell me about your ideas, and then go from there. Okay, and then we make like planning just 2 months or 3 months research. And then later on, if you have 2 months research, 2 months research, 2 months research, then you can combine and then make publication. And then go from there. And a good thing about mentoring undergraduate research, you know, for example, even though in general, actually only two, the better is you have in semester is 2 students. That's the best one. Because if you have more than 2, it's going crazy. Like me, I have 4. Oh my God, it was like, you know, it's like that. But a good thing, you know, 4. I just thinking positive. 4, okay. What kind of conference we have in the fall? Okay, we have Kentucky Academic Science, and then maybe we have symposium, just small symposium local, and then if 4 doing for A and B. So we have 8 at least, if they go all of them. But if just 3 of them or 2 of them, at least we have 4 in one semester. So if this is a year, you have 8 presentation. So it's like our assistance everywhere. Okay, and then usually based on my experience, if the student already present one time and feel good, then this is like addicted. Doing presentation is like addicted, not like make them nervous. That's my experience. The first like, oh, I cannot do that. Okay, why? Why not? No, I just not used to with presenting in front of the people, you know, Dr. S, and I'm not very good. Who said that? Well, my friend, when I was in, that's your friend. You are, do your material is good. Do you need any help? Okay, how about we go shopping? If this is a girl, I went shopping with her. Choose the outfit for presentation sometime. Because sometimes I never wear something nice, Dr. H, except going to the church. Okay. Do you have clothes that, you know, like for presentation? No. Okay, let's go shopping. And then I coach them before the presentation, usually before the symposium or conference, coach them from top to the bottom. So from, you know, and then material, I give the template, okay, for the first presenter. Usually I give the template, and then after that, practice. The first, second year, third year, usually I make them practice during the weekend, you know, because I have plenty of time, and sometime in the night, wherever they work for them, because they work, so I follow their schedule. And then after that, just go to the conference, and then go from there. And usually they are very happy after the first presentation because all the audience always, you know, give a positive input for them. Yeah. And with advising, what is different mentoring and advising? It's almost the same. It's just in my case is mentoring is have more attachment because advising is just, okay, next semester you take this. Okay, next semester, this. And you better do this one. That's it. And meet one time or 2 times in one semester. Am I right? No attachment. But mentoring is like, do you have any question? Okay, so do you need anything else, you know, like maybe literature or things that you need to do in the lab? Or do you want to go presentation somewhere? We have to find a funding, you know, and then we can work together. And then usually the student like, oh, okay, we like to go somewhere, yeah. And then it's good, my resume, right? Yes. So everything good for resume and graduate school, they love it.
For me, a mentor means a trusted advisor, teacher, and a role model, and a friend. So we have a multi-identity here, but everything is for the best of the students. And sometimes the faculty might ask, like, what to sell to the student? What to sell? Because sometimes it's difficult. When the first time I come here, I have to learn about my students. So for one semester, I didn't mentor any undergraduate student. But and then when I have class, I always announce like who has interest on doing research with me. And again, I try to adjust the research that in the student level, because for example, if I said, oh, my research is about global climate change, and then just like, what is global climate change and how to do research? But if I said, hey, anybody, for example, because I'm from agriculture, I said, anybody farmers here? Okay, so what do you want to do with your soil? And then my student will say, oh, I like to make better my soil. I like to make my soil a color become blackish or brownish, but not like red. Okay. Do you want to do that? You can do research with me. Yes, yes, yes. Then, you know, and then we start from there. And in this case, the first thing is professional relationship. You know, it's very rare to have relationship with a professor like one-to-one. For example, if they work with a bigger university, I mean, the professor might don't have time to do that. And then also job networking. Because I'm working with agriculture and also environmental science, so some of the companies sometimes ask like, hey, we have funding and then we like to do research about, for example, how to test the impact of pesticide on soil. Then we have some funding from the company and then I will advertise to my student, and from there we have networking. And also the Office of Natural Resources Conservation Office, they have little bit funding or giving internship. And from there, we can do research with students. So more job networking, resume building. Of course, if the student work in the lab or in with me, then they will put in their CV. And the most important that the student like here is because if they like to go to the graduate school, it is like a good opportunity to have like research so they can show to the graduate school in the future that they already have experience, and this is very, very good point to be accepted in a good graduate school. Grades, of course, because doing research, for example, I'm teaching what we call AGR 436, which is research in agriculture or undergraduate research in agriculture. No textbook. Usually I will give something to them like a manual, and then we are one-to-one. I mentor them in the lab or in the field, and usually if they do very good job, very, you know, like on time, everything, writing's good, a presentation is good, they will get an A, and that is very, very good for them. And grants. After a while working with me, and then we can write a proposal together, and usually the money will be only for the student, usually. So the student is happy, they got money, they got research, they got grades, so everything in one package. And skill development, of course, speaking, thinking, writing. I had experience with my previous student. When the first time I met her, she was like very, very shy and then not confident. And I said, hey, after doing research with me, remember, you have very good research, and let's join the competition for undergraduate research oral presentation. Oh no, I'm not very good on that now. And then I said, okay, well, what is your language? You know, like primary language, English. I'm not, okay, and I can present a paper, so you will be better than me. So usually she will be like, last time like, oh, okay, I mean, I will try. And then I coach them like maybe a week, and then last time my student name is Kathy LeBlanc, and the first time she speak in the presentation in Kentucky Academic Science, she won number one for oral presentation. So her confidence increased very, very well. And also the writing, the thinking, critical thinking is getting better. And how to fund the research that most faculty member ask about that? Well, internal MSU, there are several like undergraduate research office and also McNair and different kind of funding for faculty actually, but we can hire student to help us working in the field or in the lab for the purpose of our research. So there are several things, and then you can find in the website in MSU. So later on I can discuss with you if you need help for that information. And external, there are many things also depend on if you are in science or non-science, like Kentucky Academic Science and also from Kentucky Water Resources. So there are many or other like NSF or others. And what are the challenges of mentoring the undergraduate students? The first is independence. For the first month, usually you can expect that your student is not independent. You have to like mentor very well and then give leads. And usually I can see from the GPA. So if the student have a very good GPA, if I give just 3 leads, they will do like 10 leads, okay? But if they have the GPA is not good, then we have to be like very patient. But don't worry, it's only maybe a month, and after that, they will be more independent. And then we can just like, okay, if you have any question about statistics, you ask the professor X. If you have question about library, you ask about that to a professor P, for example, like that. And then also finding resources to inspire. Yeah, this one is a little bit hard, but it means we can do that actually because it's easy. We just collect some, you know, information about undergraduate research in my field, and then I put in one folder in printout and also in the, you know, in my file, and then I just send to my student, read that one, and then it's too high, you make it lighter, you know, try to send the article that a little bit light so the student can understand the research that we propose. And then finding ideas that related to mentor expertise. For my experience, usually I like my student to be creative. So for the first time we met, usually I like to ask like, what is your idea about, for example, in farming or in soil science or environmental science, and then go from there. So I don't want my student to work on the research that they don't like it or they don't have passion on that. So that's why I try, as a mentor, I try to adjust what they like and according what they want, and then go from there as a facilitator. And then some student might slow learner, some student might have fast learner. It depend on the background, so it's just we have to be patient and as like student have different background and we have to and different abilities, so we have to just work one by one. And also some student may be very very smart, but they're just too busy with other activity except research. And in this case, we just have to give an example and also just good communication with the student and then go from there. For example, I have example with one of my students. For the first year, she was working with different kind of places like coffee shop and restaurants. So she was very busy. But and then I said, hey, how about if you apply for McNair? You will get like money about $2,800 if you do research, and maybe you don't have to work on outside campus. So if you like to try, really, yeah, we can work together. Remember, doing research is like making brownies. We are team. So if you feel bad, I feel bad also. If you feel good, I feel good. So we work together. Then finally, she write the proposal. We work together, and then she got the funding, and then she quit from all the jobs. So all her time, also only for that research. So it's just we have to be really, really patient with the student. And then what are opportunities and benefits of mentoring undergraduate research for faculty? of course, apply grants. That's important for us and also for students because they will get money and also building the resume. And we have time to train the student. And also, is for faculty, we have assistant to collect data and find related references. So even though sometimes I don't have the money, but student offer me, hey, Dr. H, do you need help? Well, but I don't have money. Don't worry, because I love doing, go to the library, find some literature, because now I love doing research. So I can do for you. So what references you need? Okay. And also a good thing for me, sometimes I have to write a manuscript, and before I submit it to the journal, I can ask like, hey, do you mind if you read my manuscript just to make sure if everything okay and make sure you understand. If you do not understand, you tell me or criticize me. And then my student will, okay, because in my opinion, if my student do not understand what I'm writing, then my paper is not good. So that's my philosophy. And also, it will assist with introductory research before applying grants. Some grants, that big grants, usually need to have like a basic data, so the undergraduate student will help me to do that. And have more organized field and lab works per semester and year. Yes, they can help us with like more organization in the lab, because I have two labs on the fourth floor and third floor, and there's a lot of things going on over there, so my student really helped me to put together everything on the right place, because I'm teaching like 12 to 15 hours a semester, so you can imagine that, the impact of undergraduate working for with me is very, very good. And more manuscript will be generated, so if we have assistant, then we can more writing, and that they can help me with other things in the lab or in the classroom. And also more opportunities to present oral and poster for various scientific meetings. Today, I like to to share with you here that during my my time here, I have about like 95 presentation and abstract in various scientific meetings since 2005. So you can imagine that if I did by myself, it's impossible. Can you imagine, for example, like right now I have 3 undergraduate students with me. I mean, working for 1 semester or 1 year. And then if I have, I like to go to different scientific meeting. One scientific meeting, I can have at least 3 presentations with me, 4. And then if I join 2 scientific presentations, I have 8. 8 in 1 semester, and you multiply how long we are here. So that's one thing that it will boost our publication or our presentation or scholar activity. And then also help the university to get recognition, because if we help undergraduate students and then we have more publication, presentation, work together with undergraduate, it will make our university look wonderful. And improve teaching excellence based on my experience. If I incorporate my undergraduate research into my teaching, and also I explain like, hey, this under my student, for example, Miss X, work with me with this research, and then she gave presentation to my class, for example, just 5 or 10 minutes, and more student will come to me and ask me a lot of questions, and then based on my experience, it improved my teaching evaluation. And also increase networking for the mentor discipline. Well, based on the undergraduate research, we have a lot of networking with company, with the natural resources office, with other university, bigger university, or the same university like us. So we kind of more networking due to the undergraduate, because undergraduate has, sometimes has to, for example, working with some company, and then, hey, Dr. H, my company will give me funding, and then we do some experiment, would you please help me? And then I will help her, and then the company will give the funding and go from there, and then getting more and more networking, and I can introduce whatever the networking that I have to my students, and then go from there. And also enhance the mentor motivation to update the research through undergraduate research competition. Sometimes during the seminar or scientific meeting, I will meet other faculty member for other university, and then I know what kind of research that they're doing, that, you know, more recent, then I can, oh, this is a new methodology, new technology, and then I will ask my student, hey, how about if next semester you do that experiment like that? Do you think you will be okay? Yeah, let's discuss with the professor from other university if we can work together. So that's one thing that we try to build with other networking from other university. So for me, mentorings can make a difference. And the summary, what did I get of it as a faculty member? Again, better teaching evaluation, more publication, more presentation, more professional networking, enhanced created long-term relationship with alumni, and because especially for me, if they are my mentees right now, because they're still in Murray State University. But whenever they finish from here, all of them become my friends. If the young girls become like my daughter, if they are young boys, they are my son. So like 2 days ago, I met with my McNair scholar. All the family come to me, hey, doctors, you are my second mommy. So this make me happy when they said like that. And I have a lot of my mentees, you know, always update with all of the work, and sometimes the family, if they have new baby, they update with me. So that's one thing that I really like it about mentoring undergraduate students. And also for me, it's enhanced the health and happiness. As you seen in the previous slide that I show you, that if I don't have undergraduate student working with me, you know, and I'm just sitting in the computer like this, then I will be, after 10 years, I'll be like this. So that's one thing that is good for, you know, for us, I guess. And this is the video that about experience working with undergraduate research, and I will share with you through email. And thank you so much for coming to my workshop today. And if you have any question or any concern or any critics, please contact my email. This is my email, and thank you so much. And I hope all of you have a good day, and we can have discussion after this. Thank you.
Thank you very much.